to Jesus Christ, from whom all blessings flow. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Praise to Jesus Christ, from whom all blessings flow. Let's open up our hearts.
Open them up.
Let the living waters give our lives a start. Let's open up our hearts. And let the living waters give our lives a start.
That's where we go.
Praise His name. We praise His name. Praise His name and you will never be the same.
Hallelujah.
Praise His name. Praise His name. Praise His name and you will never be the same. Let's open up our hearts. Let the living waters give our lives a start. Open up our hearts, and let the living waters give our lives a start.
Lord, we bless you this morning, Father. Thank you for the sun shining in our hearts. Be glorified and magnified in our service today. Let your Holy Spirit rain down on us today, Father. Hearts and be open wide to you, Lord. Hey, Father,
let's open up hearts and let the living waters give our lives a start. Let's open up hearts and let the living waters give our lives a start. Praise the Lord. Christ, from whom all blessings flow.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Jesus Christ, from whom all blessings flow. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Jesus Christ, from whom all blessings flow.
Hallelujah. You were made to worship Him. Nothing else will satisfy.
Praise to Jesus Christ, from whom all blessings flow.
We love you, Lord. We praise you, Lord.
There
we go. Jesus is the rock of ages. He never changes. Put your faith in Him.
There is no rock, there is no God like our God.
No other name worthy of our praise.
No other name worthy of all our praise.
He's worthy of all our praise.
He's the rock of salvation that cannot be moved. He's proven Himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like ours.
Say first from the top.
There is no rock, there is no God like our God.
Hallelujah.
No other name worthy of all our praise. He's the rock of salvation that cannot be moved. He's proven Himself to be faithful and true.
There is no rock, there is no God like ours. He is rock of ages.
Jesus is my rock, rock of ages. Jesus is the rock, rock of ages. Jesus is the rock. There is no rock, there is no God like God.
Play it, brother. There is no rock, there is no God like our God. There's no other name worthy of all our praise.
Hallelujah.
He's the rock of salvation that cannot be moved. He's proven himself to be faithful and true. Yes, there is no rock, there is no God like God.
Solid rock.
Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of ages, Jesus is my rock. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. There is no rock, there is no God like God.
Play it, brother. Air harmonica. In the spirit, you can do it. Woo! Guitar. Air guitar.
Hallelujah.
Praise you, Lord. We praise your name this morning.
Jesus is the rock, rock of ages. Jesus is the rock, rock of ages. Jesus is the rock. There is no rock, there is no God like God,
the one and only.
There is no rock, there is no God like God.
He's on the throne right now.
There is no rock, there is no God like God.
He made the sun come up this morning. Makes your heart beat. Gives you that breath. Praise him for who he is. He's on the throne.
Rock of ages,
same yesterday, today, and forever. Put your faith in him. Rock of ages,
rock of ages,
rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Amen. Give him praise this morning, because he makes you glad when everything makes you sad. Oh, man. Thank you, Father. We rejoice in you this morning, Lord.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. Thank you, Jesus. He has made me glad. Oh, he has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. Oh, he has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad.
Yes, he has. Thank you, Jesus.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad.
Lift him up.
He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. Oh, he has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. I rejoice in your word, Lord. Made me glad. Hallelujah. He has 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 made me glad. Oh,
made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Father God. We bless your name this morning, Lord. Father in heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people declare your mighty, sing it, church. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Thank God.
Blessed be
the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore. Father, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your word come be established in our praises every day. As your people declare your mighty word, blessed be the Lord God. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore. Reigns forevermore.
Thank you, Jesus.
We love you, Lord. Reign forevermore.
Hallelujah.
Amen. What's his name? What's his name, church? Jesus, Yeshua, Son of God, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace. Trust him with everything you have this morning. He loves you, created you to worship him with every breath.
His name is Jesus, Jesus. Sad hearts weep no more. He has healed the brokenhearted, open wide the prison doors. He is able to deliver evermore. His name is Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Sad hearts weep no more. He has healed the brokenhearted, open wide the prison doors. He is able to deliver evermore.
Thank you, Jesus. Be glorified in our service today. Pray for the prayer and anointing time, that you would touch people right there, even the shut-ins that can't make it today. Touch them, Lord.
Open wide the prison doors. He He has healed the broken heart, open wide the prison doors. He is able to deliver evermore.
Trust them today. Trust them today. He's here this morning. Many years ago, when I first became a believer, one of the first songs I learned was this hymn written in the 16th century. And it was exalting the Lord above everything else. It's amazing. Listen to the lyrics. 1600s it was written. Jesus is above everything. Above everything. That's how we exalt you here this morning, Lord.
There is Lord Jesus, ruler of nature, O thou of God and man the Son, thee will I share. Fair are the meadows, fair is still the woodlands, robed in the blooming garb of spring. But Jesus is fairer, Jesus is purer. Of you, Lord, we sing of you. There is the sunshine, fair still the moonlight, and all the twinkling starry host. But Jesus is brighter. Jesus is purer than all the angels heaven can boast.
Hallelujah. Above it all, he's my beautiful Savior, Lord of all the nations. Son of God and Son of Man, glory and honor, praise, adoration, now and forevermore be Let him touch you this morning. Remember, yesterday's gone, tomorrow's not here yet, but he's here right now. Here's that song Bill Gaither wrote, and I'll never forget it. I've been singing it ever since he touched me. Let him touch you this morning. He desires, he cares for you.
Shackled by a heavy burden, neath the touch me.
Yes, Lord.
And I am no longer.
Hallelujah. That's right.
He touched me.
Hey, good morning, everybody.
Good morning,
it's a snow
church.
Day.
Yes, it is.
Not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. Up at our house here, it's like the roads are covered. Nobody's out. State of emergency. And we're glad you could join us via YouTube. And Lord, keep the internet up. So we want to pray with you this morning, and then we're going to go to the anointing of oil. But we're just grateful that we could be here. I kind of put an edit together with some worship from last week. But the words will be there and you can enjoy it. And then we'll have the great message. We're going to continue on in 1 Peter chapter 4. But but first, we want to start off with prayer. Lord, thank you for bringing everybody here today, keeping them safe at home. Keep the power on. Keep the heat running. And let them have food in the box so they could and just enjoy their downtime with you, Jesus. I'll open up the word to them.
Thank you, Jesus.
And just be with each person represented here.
Yes.
If they're not feeling well, touch them. But right now, we want to go to the anointing of oil in Jesus' name.
Thank you,
Amen.
Jesus.
And what it says in James is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Anyone among you cheerful? Let him sing psalms. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And verse 15 in James chapter 5 says, and the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effectant, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. I want to ask Andrea to pray for anybody that's sick today, and then I'm going to anoint her with oil in Jesus' name. Go ahead, Andy.
Lord, we just thank you so much for our LCA church family.
Yes, God.
We miss them so much, Lord.
Yes, God.
They are such a huge part of our heart, and we're just so blessed to be able to serve them, Father. And Lord, at this time, we just lift those in our congregation that are not feeling well. Lord God, we just want to lift up Brother Robert as he is getting stronger and stronger, but he still has a way to go. We want to lift up our sister Stacy, for Lord, I know that she is overcoming many things in her life, and I thank you that she is your daughter and you will continue to provide for her. Thank you for the miracle in Judy's life. Lord, thank you for bringing Barbara through. Lord, so many things we are grateful for.
Yes,
and
God.
So, Father, we thank you. We're always mindful of your blessings and your benefits. And we pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, to keep us all strong, following hard after you with hearts towards you.
Yes,
Lord Jesus,
Lord.
Give us opportunities to be Jesus with skin on. In the name of Jesus.
Yes, God.
Amen.
Amen. So we did that for you today in the name of the Lord. Receive it. In Jesus' name. Now Andrew's got some announcements. I know it's a little out of the loop, but she's got some announcements, so then we'll put this together for you so you could have the Word of God. That's the most important thing today.
Amen. Oh, and we also want to pray for baby Ellie. We just thank you, Lord, that have brought her through. And
thank you,
God
Jesus.
Bless Gretchen and Gary for the beautiful example of godly parents that they are to their children. Lord, we thank you that you will... They've had enough cooties going on over the past couple weeks, and I pray, Father, that it'll come to an end and they will walk in perfect health, covered by the blood of Jesus.
Yes, God.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, announcements. On this Tuesday, February 1st, we have our Knitted Hearts Bible study. It'll start at 10 o'clock. Ladies, please bring your lunch because we will be studying in chapter 13 of Proverbs. You can review that before you come if you have time. Also, there was a handout that we're going to do as a devotional about the attributes and the names of God. We'll be doing that to open our Bible study. And then bring your lunch because we'll fellowship afterwards as we always do. It's a great time as the Lord continues to knit our hearts together. And Saturday the 5th will be the men's study. They are in Proverbs also. They'll be meeting downstairs in the fellowship hall at 9 o'clock.
Great time of fellowship, guys. I need you. Iron sharpens iron. We need each other. And when we come together like that, it's so wonderful. I appreciate you coming so much.
Amen. Amen. And on February 13th, right after church, we're going to be having a class for people who are interested in being baptized. We've reserved the pool at Keswick on February 20th.
Heated.
Yeah, heated. After church. Not a good day to go swimming today, huh? After church at 1 o'clock, and we're going to have a baptism. So anyone who wants to rededicate their lives or get baptized for the first time, please let us know. The class will be the 13th after church, and the baptism will be the 20th at Keswick at 1 o'clock.
Let's God go down to the river and pray.
Amen. We miss you guys. God bless you.
Okay, thank you, Andy. All right, I want to get the Bible set up here. I got the Word of God. If you have your Bible, open to 1 Peter. And we're continuing on in chapter 4. But last week we finished chapter 3 and started in chapter 4. And here's what we learned: our life lessons to remember and apply to our lives. Application, being doers and not just hearers, all of us. So the life lessons last week was, number one, tetelestai. The price for our sin is paid in full. That's a wonderful thing. You ever go to a restaurant and somebody says, here, somebody paid your check. Well, Jesus paid our life check. Totally. Thank you. Receive it and walk in it every day. Number two, Jesus told the enemy that he has no authority over us. Bam. No authority. Hit the pit. Number three, baptism is an outward expression of an inside change. It's an announcement to the world. Hey, I'm not the same person anymore. Number four, we fight from victory, from victory, and not for victory. It's not like we're going to the Super Bowl and we're going to win this game. Get out there and give it all you got. No, thank God. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. And number five, we leave our sin nature behind. Behind. When you're driving down the highway, you don't drive looking in that rearview mirror. I mean, sometimes you glance at it, and we do that in life, too. We go back to the stinking thinking, and the enemy comes up and goes, remember what you did? But we fight from victory. Jesus won the victory. Thank God. We don't have to do it. All we have to do is, in him we live, breathe, and have our being, as the scripture says. Number five, we leave our sin nature behind. And number six, get ready to meet Jesus. Boy, if that was ever true, it's now. So today. Get ready to meet the Lord. Live your life today as if he's coming at dinner time. Get everything in order. Make your account short. And there's 2 points I want to emphasize from last week. Number one, when Jesus died, he paid the price for our sin in full. And number two, he broke the authority that the enemy has in our lives. If we're born again, big if. Make sure you're right with God. The enemy has no right to mess with us, because the only foothold that he has on us is our sin. It's like ankle weights. You ever wore ankle weights when you were exercising? I used to have to wear them sometimes. Man, them things were heavy. Or the old ball and chain from the chain gang days. That's what the sin does, you know? Sin has been eradicated. We are washed clean. When the enemy tries to mess with you, remind him that he's in violation. He has no authority in our lives. We belong to Jesus. Isn't that great? We belong to Jesus. He's mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Jesus is mine. It's very important that we get these powerful truths down in our heart. Where? Down in our heart. Where? Down in our heart. That's the seat right there. When you're walking that victory, and that important, powerful truth is in your heart, that I'm a born-again Christian, I'm washed in the blood, I've been forgiven, and I operate that way. So let us continue. Open your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 4. Crack it open, chapter 4. We're going to be in chapter 4, and we're going to begin in verse 8 from the New King James. I'm going to be reading today. Verse 8 says this, and above all things, have fervent love for one another, For love will cover a multitude of sins, unquote. Notice the phrase, above all. Peter's emphasizing the importance of our love for one another. I love you. I love you. I have to walk in that love every day. And God reminds me that I love you. You're my brother. You're my sister. Andrea and I just got a little doggy, Pearly May, and she's in the back because we didn't want her cutting in on the message. But we'll put up some pictures in the coming weeks of she had a makeover. Oh, man, does she look different from when she came in? But we have a firm in love. You look at Pearly May's face and it just melts you like butter on a pancake grill. It's beautiful. She's wiggled her way into our hearts. When I look at her, my heart explodes, boom, with love for her. She could just melt you. It's just amazing. And the dog's been through so much. I just look at her every day and say, I love you. I've never had any children, but for those of you who do, you can relate in looking at your children with so much love. There's nothing like that. You probably had the same kind of heart exploding love that I have when I look at Pearly May. He loves us intensely, even when we do things that are not quite right. Man, how many times have I blown it? But his love is steadfast. That's that word agape, or where we have it on the wall, ever reminding us about it, you know? It's so important. And that's how we are to love one another. We have to cultivate that every day. And being in the scriptures really helps us with that. We're to love each other with agape, unconditional love, respecting each other, caring for one another, putting others' needs above our own. Man, I was so selfish all my life. You know, I kind of grew up without a family, so I became extra selfish because I had to survive out there. So I took care of business for me. When I came to the Lord and did that U-turn, I had to learn the opposite. And I'm still learning every day. My wife helps me with that because she's been doing it a lot longer than me. But I ask God for his grace and his power and his enablement. And he does that. And he puts that love down in my heart. Jesus is our example of love. He tells us in John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35 in the New King James, it says this, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. Verse 35 says, by this all will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another, unquote. Quite honestly, it's not an easy thing for us to love others as Jesus loved us, especially when we're struggling because someone has hurt us or rubbed us the wrong way. Ouch. Sometimes it can be painful out there. And when we have relationships and they hurt, you know, one misplaced word, an attitude, a look. But here's a promise when we're struggling with love. 1 Thessalonians 4:9. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 9 says, but concerning brotherly love, you have no need that I should write to you, for you yourselves are taught by God to love one another. God teaches us to love one another. God teaches us how to love one another. If we ask him, praying for someone when we're struggling with, praying for someone we are struggling with has a way of softening our hearts. I just went through this with an issue with somebody in my past, and I asked God to help me with it, and now we have a relationship where before we were like, I don't want nothing to do with him. But God softened the hearts. He has a way of softening our hearts toward that person and cultivating room to grow. And I've heard stories in the past where people were almost mortal enemies and they're best friends today. God can do that. God has a way of doing that. It's so beautiful where victims have been united with their perpetrators in a crime situation where God changed a heart and hearts. So trust him for that today. The second part of this verse is love will cover a multitude of sins. In Proverbs chapter 10, verse 12, it says, hatred stirs up strife, but love covers all sins. Love is so powerful. We see it in our daily lives out here, even through tragic situations where there's natural disasters, fires, famines, floods, people come together. Something happens. Total strangers helping each other. And they become friends. Yeah, I used to love that show, 911. It was the emergency response. And I used to watch it because I've got that first responder in me. And you'd see situations where there was a car accident and the paramedics came and they saved the person's life. And now they're friends for life. Every time they see each other, they just, wow, and they just explode. That's what God does with us. And he covers so much. It means to forgive. Forgiveness is associated with love. The best example of love, of a love that covers sin, is Jesus' sacrificial death on our behalf. His agape love toward us covered a multitude. Luke 23:34 says this, and then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." Of course, Jesus did more than cover our sin. He did away with it completely. Tetelestai, it's finished. He did it. He took care of it. It's done. Oh, how beautiful that is. He's our example in forgiveness. We are all different and operate differently. We love and appreciate each other in spite of all our personality quirks and funny habits, and we all got them. We love and appreciate each other. How boring it would be if we were all the same. Can you imagine that? If we were all the same. Boring. When we love each other, we are willing to forgive each other. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5 says, "Love keeps no record of being wrong." Let me read that again. 1 Corinthians 13, 5b, second part of that verse. Love keeps no record of being wrong. We hurt each other when we sin against each other. We cover others' sin by acknowledging it and then extending the forgiveness God has given us to others. Freely give, freely been given, freely give. We are all imperfect. And quite honestly, some sins against us are not worth confronting. Personal slights, snide, or ignorant remarks, minor annoyances can easily be forgiven for the sake of love. However, covering sin does not mean that we just sweep it under the rug. Indiscretions and behavior that are harmful to others have to be handled accordingly. Serious offenses are to be handled according to Matthew 18, beginning in verse 15. "Moreover, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you have gained your brother." Verse 16, "But if he will not hear, take with you one or two more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established," unquote. So here is what we do. Number one, we go to our brother or sister first. First step. Number two, if they won't hear you, seek counsel from others. Paul Kearns, who attended LCA for many years, recently went to be with the Lord. I got to see him on his way up. Oh, God. He had the joy of the Lord in his heart. It was a beautiful thing to see. He went to be with the Lord. He had a saying when he was a sergeant on the police department. I've told you about him before. He would tell the officers when they were on their way out to hit the streets for patrol that people deserve a break today. It was almost like that commercial, "You deserve a break today." And he would emulate that. And he would say, "Cut them some slack." If the offense was minimal, someone might be having a bad day, let them off the hook. If the infraction was serious, deal with it accordingly. This is a good guide for us to handle our personal relationships. Continuing on in chapter 4, verse 9, "Be hospitable to one another without grumbling." Be hospitable to one another without grumbling. I have to remind myself of that every day. It's so important. When Peter was writing this letter, the church was under severe persecution. Some of them had begun to scatter, leaving everything behind to hide in the catacombs. It was like an ant farm. You ever seen an ant farm? Those little tunnels, I love watching an ant farm. It's so incredible, those little critters. God says to look to them. But anyway, catacombs looked like those little tunnels, you know? And it's amazing, leaving everything to hide behind to hide in the catacombs. Some of them began to scatter, and Peter was telling the church, as he's telling us now, to share what we have with others. Don't hoard it in there and build that bomb shelter, and you've got everything in there, and then when the bomb goes off, you're just going to live in that bomb shelter till you run out of stuff. Hello? Let God handle it. He has such a good way of doing that. That could be an offering of hospitality in our homes for others. It could be offering support to others who have lost their homes, such as the many horrendous disasters we've seen. And, you know, that's why I was talking earlier. When you see those things happen and you see people come out of the funniest places to help each other. They drive for miles. They'll fly in. They'll Samaritan's Purse sends teams out, and they just start to work and love on the people. And the cool thing about being a believer is you can always offer that extra love. Can I pray for you? Let me pray for you. And I've done this as a chaplain. Most people will say, yes, please do. It's a wonderful thing to share our blessings, and God has a way of replenishing them to overflowing. Remember, you can't outgive God no matter how hard you try. You can't outgive him. Hebrews 13:2. Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by doing so, some have unwittingly entertained angels. Oh, I got a lot of stories of this in my days of going out, but I know I've hit angels along the route. You know, there was we were in Burger King once when we had the motorhome, and we stopped and we were getting some lunch, and there was a lady in the opposite line, an older lady, and she was struggling to get the money, and she didn't have any money to pay. Well, she was digging, and it was holding up the line. So I looked at Andrew. I said, just pay for our lunch. So we paid for our lunch, and then she scampered toward the door, and I said, go see, because she was having a hard time with her belongings, and she was just disheveled and walking out the door. I said, Andy, go check her out. I'll get the order. And by the time Andy got to the door and she was out the door, the lady disappeared. There was no way to see. She wasn't in a car. She wasn't walking. So, I mean, there's situations like that, you know. If we see an opportunity and sense the Lord's leading to bless someone, do it. Continuing on in chapter 4, verse 10. As each one has received a gift, minister it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. The manifold grace of God. It goes out. And it's like a manifold on a car. If anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. If anyone ministers, let him do it with the ability which God supplies, that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom belong the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Think about that. Jesus Christ, to whom belong the glory and the dominion forever and ever. He's on the throne. He's in charge. He knows what he's doing. Rest in him. Work in him. Breathe in him. Live in him. We all have gifts and abilities. We should use our abilities faithfully to serve others as the Lord directs, not as we please. Our gifts and abilities are not for our own exclusive use. There are so many in this church, and I love this, who use their gifts and talents for the Lord. Here's a microcosm of the whole Christian move on this earth. Right here at LCA, the children's church workers can be concerned about their own children and grandchildren, but they do more. They spend time teaching the LCA children about Jesus. Fred and Nova can stay home and cook for their own, but they do more. They make us breakfast each month. Charlie, George, and Carrie can choose to use their talents for their own houses, but they do more. They use their abilities to fix up God's house, their temple tenders. I love that. Dorothy and the office crew can choose to just keep their own personal bookkeeping straight, but they do more. They work hard to keep the church's finances in order, and it's a big job. All of these and many more of you choose to bless the church with what the Lord has given you, and we appreciate and are grateful to each and every one of you. We don't know how the church would operate without the body using their gifts to be a blessing. Thank you for being a blessing. When we use our gifts as he directs, others will see Jesus in us. and glorify him for the help they received or the words they have heard. Represent. That's a big word. Who do you represent? Represent. You walk with that uniform on. I love Jesus, and I love you too. It speaks volumes. Matthew chapter 5, verse 16, let your light shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. How beautiful. Continuing on in chapter 4, verse 12, beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you as though some strange thing happened to you. Verse 13, but rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. It's so hard to see that sometimes through the fog, but that's the scripture admonishing us to be partakers with Christ's suffering. And when we go through that suffering, we realize that Jesus went before us and we get the honor to suffer along with him. That when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. I'm looking forward to that. Fiery trials happen to us all. Some of them are severe and just absolutely heartbreaking. When things happen, we often ask ourselves, why did this happen to me? There's no answer. The Bible tells us in Matthew chapter 5, verse 45, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven, for he makes the sun rise on the evil and on the good, and he sends rain on the just and the unjust, unquote. Both unsaved people and saved people go through the same trials and sufferings. Some difficulties are simply a part of human life, and everybody has them. As we learned last week, suffering keeps us focused on heaven. Suffering is a part of how we grow as Christians. Suffering is not something which is accidental. It's the normal experience, the normal Christian experience. I always tell people that, you know, I'm working with people that are going through horrendous trials, and maybe they're out there doing their thing with drugs or alcohol. And I'll say, hey, I'm just as messed up and jacked up as you, but the only difference is I allow God to work through me. Big deal. That's a big deal. God works through me as a conduit. I allow him to, and he takes care of all the details. But I struggle and bump against walls and trip just like everybody else. But I have that relationship with my Lord. He's my good shepherd. He guides and directs me. So the suffering is an opportunity for us to learn to trust God and leaning on the everlasting arms. I love that song. Lean on his promises. Being a Christian doesn't mean that we will have a carefree life, free from pain, free from sickness, free from struggle, free from financial burdens, free from heartbreak. I've heard people say that any trial, suffering, and sickness in our lives is caused by because of our sin. Sometimes that can be true. But we cause our own misery. But most of the time, life just happens. Every day. That's why the Lord said, get up every day and start each day with him first. And then get his directions from the scriptures. And move out. And throughout the day, pray. Pray without ceasing. God will carry you through the minefield that's out here. It's because we live in a fallen world, and now we see it more than ever all around us, you know. It just rips your heart out. I heard the testimony of the widow of the police officer that got killed last week in New York. It would just rip your heart out. They were so young, they just got married, and so much pain right off the top. But God will carry them through. She was sharing this in the church, sharing it, how God's moving in her life, even through the pain and suffering. Jesus gave us a wonderful illustration concerning suffering when he reminded us that after a woman endures pain and suffering to give birth, she forgets about the agony when her baby is born because the suffering is transformed into glory. The same baby who causes pain brings joy. Can I get an amen, sisters? during our suffering, whatever the cause, we need to remember the faithfulness of God and his promises. I love this verse in Isaiah chapter 43, verse 2. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flames scorch you, unquote. And this one in Romans chapter 8, verse 28, the classic verse. And we know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose, unquote. The sadness and suffering in our personal lives and in the world is overwhelming. Oh man, what a couple of days after we've had these incidents here in the Northeast with the murder of police officers. And nationwide, by the way. But it just, for me, it's so hard as a law enforcement chaplain to see this. And because I know when an incident happens, whether it's with police or a car, bus accident, plane crash, there's so many people that are affected by the incident. However, we have hope because we know that God allows it. God will be with us. God will use it for his glory. We have all these things that we go through, and when we come out of one, guess what's waiting for us around the corner? In tough times, we need to focus and find our comfort in the God who is sovereign and loves us. Excuse me 1 minute. I just got to clear out my nose. Winter time. Continuing on in chapter 4, 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 14. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you. For the Spirit of glory and the God and of God rest upon you. Let me start again. Verse 14. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. On their part, he is blasphemed, but on your part, he is glorified. Peter brings to mind Jesus' words in Matthew 5:11. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Often when we share our faith, we take a stand for the Lord. We are looked at funny, ridiculed, accused of being judgmental or politically incorrect. And they are thoughtless of this can hurt us and cause us to feel rejected. However, we need to keep at the forefront that the Bible says that when we are reviled and persecuted, we are blessed. It's so important. The Lord will send his Spirit to strengthen those who are persecuted for their faith. The quote, Pastor J.C., John Carhart, from Lacey Christian Assembly, when you take a stand for Jesus, he will stand for you. Can I get an amen? Amen. Think about this next time you are made fun of because of your faith. When we suffer for Christ, it's an honor and a privilege. Continuing on in chapter 4, verse 15, but let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as a busybody in other people's matters. Peter puts murder right down with gossiping and criticizing others. Ouch! He makes no distinction between them all. I find it very interesting that all of these things produce death. Stay away from it. Avoiding them produces life in us and others. Unfortunately, we bring some of the difficulties on ourselves because of disobedience and sin. Peter says that we should not be suffering for our own sins. I think we can all agree with Peter. We go through enough things in our life to challenge us. We don't need to go adding to the list by making things worse for ourselves through our own disobedience. It can be very costly, you know, and I'm ever reminded of that with the people that I work with daily, that I counsel, that people that come to me for help from all walks of life, from all over the country. You know, it can really be hard. But we keep pushing people in that direction. I keep pushing myself when I read the scriptures and my relationship with the Lord. He's constantly pushing me in the right direction. Peter gives us good advice here. For the church back then and for us now, verse 16, yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. We should never be ashamed to suffer for being a Christian. When Peter and the other apostles were persecuted for preaching the good news, they rejoiced because such persecution was a mark of God's approval for their work. Acts chapter 5, verse 41 says, so they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name, unquote. As we learned in verse 14, persecution for our faith is a blessing and worth rejoicing about. This beating suffered by Peter and John was the first time any of the apostles had been physically abused for their faith. These men knew how Jesus suffered, and they praised God that he allowed them to be persecuted like the Lord. Wow. The next time we tell someone about Jesus and they tell us to keep it on our side of the street and return the Bible that we gave them, this just happened to me recently, we shouldn't get angry. And my first thing was, what do you mean giving that back to me? But God said, let me work. And we get our feelings hurt by something like that. We should rejoice because what we are doing, we're doing the right thing. We should be honored that Jesus would allow us to do that. Worthy to suffer disgrace for the name of Jesus. So I have to recalibrate my fleshly thinking, which wants to lash out. And God says, oh no, I'm working. In spite of what you see, in spite of their actions, I'm working. Always trust God to work. Continuing on chapter 4, verse 17. For the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? Verse 18. Now, if the righteous one is scarcely saved, where will the ungodly and the sinner appear? Unquote. Peter reminded us that the wicked will face God's judgment. When he said in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 5, they will give an account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. However, he's reminding us as believers in Christ that we must hold ourselves to a higher standard. Remember that commercial? What was that? Hebrew National? I work for a higher authority. I used to love that commercial. We must hold ourselves to a higher standard than the world does. We have talked about this many times. Keep your testimony pure. That's a lot to say. You don't hear that kicked around too often, even in the church. But it's so important. My pastor used to constantly remind me of that. Keep your testimony pure. And then I had the unfortunate instance of backsliding and bringing disgrace on my testimony. And I saw the results of that. And people that looked at me for a spiritual reasons were brokenhearted when they heard I fell apart. But I learned a valuable lesson about staying close to the Lord and keeping my testimony pure. So I encourage you, keep your testimony pure. Always stop challenging Jews. There's a word I'm learning too with my health program, but it's true in our walk with the Lord. Stop and challenge ourselves about our life and our message that we send to people and choose. Choose Jesus. What would Jesus do? Remember that? We talked about this many times. We keep our testimony pure. We live holy. We live as holy witnesses to the Lord. Continuing on in chapter 4, verse 19. Therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God commit their souls to him in doing good as to a faithful creator. He's faithful and true. We sing it every week at the close of the service for a reason. He's faithful. He never lets us down. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. Those who have really suffered know what it's like to commit themselves to God. Those who have really suffered know what it is to commit themselves to God. Commitment, commitment, commitment. To trust him with all of their hearts. Peter is telling us to commit our souls to our Creator. Of all the titles for God, Peter said, when you suffer, commit your soul to your Creator. Why did he pick Creator? I love that word, Creator. God is the creator of everything, including the situation which you're suffering right now. He's the creator. Nothing can happen that God doesn't allow. You know, sometimes when he turns up the heat, he keeps his hand on the thermometer. Ooh. He's the creator. He's the creator of the person whom you married. I know that when I look at my wife. Thank you, Jesus. The person to whom you work with, the neighbor whom you live, you know, even if they're down the street and you know what they're doing. He's the creator of every situation because he's our creator. He made the situations and the challenges around us, so trust God with all of them. He's large and in charge. He loves us. Proverbs chapter 3, 5 and 6, classic, classic verse in the middle of the Bible. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own spaghetti. No, it doesn't say spaghetti. I used to say that because I used to do a lot of children's church. Lean not on your own spaghetti because the brain sometimes, you see a picture of it, looks like a bowl of spaghetti. Here, let me sing it again. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him. And he shall direct your paths. We used to sing that so many times, but we're going to sing it at the end. But we had some life lessons today. Let me get my beautiful wife.
I'm back.
Right here. In fact, you should have just sat here the whole time because you smell so wonderful and you look so beautiful. Okay, life lessons for today. What were the life lessons? What was number one today?
Number one, love people. Because they deserve a break today.
Love people because they deserve a break today. That's a good one. How about number two?
Share what you have with others.
Share what you have with others. That was a hard one for me, but you know what? Every time I do it now, I just get this warm glow in my... It's almost like my heart is doing jumping jacks. Like, yeah, that's a good thing. And number three says what?
Use our gifts and abilities to serve others.
Use our gifts and abilities to serve. Make me a servant, humble and meek. Amen. Okay. Number four says,
don't focus on the problem. Focus on the problem solver.
Yeah, just like Tino Welinda used to do when he walked the high wire. He said his grandfather told him to focus on an immovable object, fixed. And Jesus, keep your eyes on the center of the cross. Keep your eyes on the prize. Don't focus on the problem. Focus on the problem solver, Jesus. And number five says,
we are honored and blessed when we're persecuted in the name of Jesus or for the name of Jesus.
So we're in good company.
Yeah.
When we're blessed. And when we're honored, we are honored and blessed when we are persecuted. I have to really, that one you have to work at. Because nobody wants to be persecuted. But the Lord, isn't it amazing how the Lord lives from a different angle than the world? And number six says what?
Fully trust our Creator.
Fully trust our Creator. That means with everything.
Mm-hmm. With everything. He's large and in charge.
Remember that song we used to sing at Calvary Ranch? Let's teach you a song to close out the service. Then we're going to have some worship at the end, which I edit together and put the service together for you today. But this is a song we used to sing at Calvary Ranch, and it went like this. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not unto your own understanding in all your ways. Acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. Sing it with us, church. Here we go. Ready? Trust in the Lord with all your heart
and lean not unto thy own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. And he shall direct thy path.
Amen. Lord, thank you for your word today. Bless everybody as they're home and safe in their house. And if somebody's watching this out of the area, this is our church. This is how we do it, Lord, for you. We go into your word, simply teaching the Bible, simply. And Lord, I pray you would give everybody a good week. Let them get out of the house and be able to clean up safely as they do it carefully and not to slip or fall or overexert. And that you would clear up the weather this week and make us come together again at church on Wednesday in Jesus' name. Amen. See you soon, church. We love you.
Amen. We do.
Do it right now. They would say that simple prayer. Say, Dear Father, I come to you now in Jesus' name. And I ask you, Father, forgive me of my sins. I invite your Son, Jesus Christ, into my heart as my Lord and as my Savior. With my mouth, I confess Jesus Christ. And in my heart, I believe that you raised them from the dead. Now, according to your word, I'm born again. I'm saved. All my sins have been forgiven me. I'm yours and you're mine. Help me, Father, to live a life for you from this moment on. In Jesus' name, amen. That's it. If you said that prayer and you meant it, you're set. Now you got to grow in him. Just get a Bible and start reading it, praying every day, fellowshipping. And like I said, we're going to have baptism. So come on by. Sign up on that sheet in the back. Let's close the service. We're going to have fellowship downstairs. And we'll have some great bagels.
Faithful and true, faithful to love us. You, Lord, are faithful, faithful and true. You, Lord, are faithful, faithful and true. So faithful to love us. You, Lord, are faithful and true. And when there comes a time I falter, I call upon your name, and I know that you are faithful to remove my guilt and shame.
Lord, I pray that everybody would have a great day in you. Help us to be witnesses for you in these crazy times, and lift up all our prayer concerns to you, Lord. We'll be sure to give you all the praise and the glory of what you're doing here at LCA, in our homes, in our community, and in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
And when there comes a time I falter, and I call upon your name, I know that you are faithful to remove my guilt and shame. Lord, you, Lord, are faithful, faithful and true, faithful to love us.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, are faithful.
Thank you, Jesus.
Faithful.
Thank you for all the people here, Lord.
You, Lord, are faithful.
Work in their hearts and lives.
faithful and true,
so faithful to love us,
you are.